Mr. Chairman, everyone, Mr. Lawyer Hasan. It's an honor for me to be presiding over the first Professor Mushirul Hasan Memorial Lecture. Many of my colleagues knew Professor Mushirul Hasan when he was a student here, one of our very brightest students. Much was expected from him, and of course, he became one of India's premier historians. It is also fitting that the first memorial lecture for him should be devoted to Gandhiji's legacy, Gandhi today. It should be delivered by Professor Prashottam. I would like to say in a kind of amplification or summarization, whatever you might call it, of Professor Agarwal's lecture, that Gandhi was a religious man and we should recognize it. There's nothing to be wrong in being religious. I know R.P. that criticized him for his statement that he was a Hindu, but surely then Abul Kalam Azad and Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan should have been criticized also for saying they are Muslims. In fact, when the Khudai Khidmat Guards raised national slogans, they said, Bande Mataram Allahu Akbar. So it's not a question of what kind of Hindu or Muslim, whether you are Hindu or Muslim, but what kind of Hindu and what kind of Muslim. And I think here the first thing we forget is that Gandhiji contributed indirectly a considerable influence on reshaping Hinduism. A Hinduism without caste, a Hinduism in which Dalits would be treated as equals, in which untouchability would be rejected, a Hinduism committed to ahimsa, a Hinduism committed to friendly relations with members of other religions. R.P. Dutt criticizes Gandhiji for saying that he was a Sanatani Hindu. But when his wife went to the Puri temple, Gandhi didn't speak in anger for 3 days. Why did you go for idol worship? Is it this Sanatani Hindu? He changed or tried to change a whole religion. And in fact, he had succeeded. In 1970s, I think, the picture of Hinduism was the picture that Gandhi had created. By 1919, that picture has now been rejected by tendencies that we know about. Internal difficulties and, of course, the development of RSS and other reactionary forces of that kind. And, of course, helped by Muslim separatism. Secondly, I would like to argue that Gandhi had a concept of nation which was far more humanistic than we now consider a nation. Jawaharlal Nehru, I think, was right in being very suspicious of the idea of nation. Anti-colonialism, yes, but a nation seems to be at conflict with other nations. So the very idea of a nation, he thought, was an idea that other nations should be opposed. With Gandhiji, I think the idea of nation was different, that it should be inherently friendly with other countries. And I think, of course, it was for this reason that he was shot down. Because on his last fast, he had demanded not only that Muslims should be allowed to return to their houses in Delhi, but that 55 crores, which were due to Pakistan, should be paid to them. So, today, I think RSS people should call him anti-national, because we who believe in good relations with Pakistan Huawei and with other countries are not asking us, asking our country to pay anything to Pakistan. But Gandhi was asking to pay 55 crores and force the government of India to agree to that decision. And for that, he lost his life. I should also like to bring some other aspects which are inherent and implicit in Professor Agarwal's lecture on Gandhi. And two of these would also come out from the type of questions that were asked. The first is about the Dalit question. First of all, I would say that nobody asks why Ambedkar cooperated with British rulers, why he went before the Simon Commission, when every self-respecting Indian leader rejected it, why when Quit India had taken place, he joined the Viceroy's Council as a member of it, and what on earth did he do as a member of Viceregal Council? What did he do for the Dalits? Did he make any demand for their immediate preservation? What did he do? So, I'm afraid Ambedkar is not such a figure as one should make out, and one should boldly say it, that this for record. The second thing is, and Professor Agarwal had pointed out that in 1915, the very time that Gandhi arrived in India, he had that problem of the scheduled caste, of the Dalit couple. And he was actually moving into the Dalit Basti, the Bhangi Basti as it was called, in Ahmedabad, when a sheikh came and gave him 13,000 rupees. And so his ashram was saved at that time. So the courage of the man, at that time, could anyone, any Muslim middle class man, or any Muslim would have dared to go into a Bhangi Basti and live there? Tell me. Whatever the equality of Islam may be there, but has it ever been done? And then we come to Pune Pact. Everyone denounces the Pune Pact without reading it. The communal award by the British government had only awarded 70 seats to the scheduled class in separate constituencies out of 700 provincial legislature seats. There was no allotment for the central legislature. The Pune Pact raised the quota to 148 seats, more than double. Then they say that there was no separate electorate that was washed off by Pune Pact. They have not read the Pune Pact. The Pune Pact said that in these reserved constituencies, there would first be an election among scheduled caste. And then they will elect four. And it would be only among these four that election would then take place. Why on earth the British accepted it? Why on earth did Ambedkar and British remove the first clause? The reason is obvious. By 1936, through the Harijan campaign of Mahatma Gandhi, it was obvious that the first candidate elected by Dalit constituencies would be a congressman. It would blow up the entire illusion of Ambedkar's leadership of the scheduled caste. The records are there, you can see it. It is characteristic of the Congress today that they don't come forward with these happenings, this kind of information. It's just characteristic. The BJP may say that, you know, you did nothing for the peasants. They don't come forward and say, who abolished the zamindari system? You were supporting the zamindari system. So apart from everything, Congress must be accused of total ignorance and of total rejection of its own heritage. The second thing, the other thing about Muslims. When Gandhi established the Indian National, the Indian Congress, the Natal Indian Congress in 1893, 90% of its members were Muslims. 90%. Its financiers were Muslims. when he came to India, his major slogan during World War I was release Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali. And then he was supporting the war, you know. He forgot violence and non-violence there. He was supporting that. He was a human being and he was a tactician. The Viceroy held a conference, Imperial Conference in support of the war, in which you look up a list, all your great Muslim leaders were there praising the cause, praising the government in impeccable English. One man spoke up in Hindustani, and he said in Hindustani, release Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali. So, this is the courage of the man. Did Raja Mahmud Abbas say so? They say so. Did anyone else say so? He alone. And it was all the time his demand that Muhammad Ali and Shaukat Ali should be released. In 1920, on the question of Khilafat, which was actually also a question of the independence of Turkey and blocking imperialist domination of the Middle East, the demand that non-cooperation should be initiated came from Gandhi, not from any Muslim leader. It came from Gandhi. So, that is the kind of man he was. He was able to throw himself totally into non-cooperation for his slogan, which was deemed to be inherently Muslim in character. Of course, he had to expand the slogan to cover Swaraj and the Punjab wrongs. But essentially, it was his Muslim slogan which he used. And of course, as far as the riots are concerned, Gandhi's role is beyond praise, particularly in 1947-48. I will end by saying that in the History Congress, I praised myself when I was speaking of Gandhi's heritage. And then I said that one Gandhi was killed in the RSS and Hindu Mahasabha, people distributed sweets. Because I'm an old man now, at that time I was a student, university student, I joined the, along with other students, I joined the great procession which marched through Delhi, through Aligarh, denouncing the murderers. And at the Sarrafa, where it was said that the sweetmeats had been distributed, I was among that crowd who shouted, Mahasabha Sangh Walon ko phansi do, phansi do. I am proud of it. Soon we were pushed to one side by the huge Congress procession singing, Ishwar Allah, Tere Hi Naam, Sabko Sanmati De Bhagwan. Thank you.